I get a lot of people that are like, hey, I want a house hack, or I want to buy a duplex or a quadplex. I want to live in one side and I want to rent the other stuff out. I want to run an Airbnb on the other side, whatever they're going to do, right? So we've done that a lot. And I think that is for a first time home buyer or for somebody who's interested in kind of, I don't know, getting ahead, maybe is the word to use, and making really strong financial decisions, house hacking is the way to go, man.
Totally agree. What I would say is if you're a single person, or let's say you're a younger person that doesn't need the space, right? Unfortunately for me, it doesn't work. I have two kids, we have a small dog, and we need the space, right? But looking back on it, my first purchase was a condo. I purchased in Boca Bayou back in 2005. I said to myself, I live out in West Boca. When I graduated from FAU, I said, my plan is to go as far east as I can possibly afford. Unfortunately, it wasn't the beach. So I moved out to Boca Bayou, which is just...
Great neighborhood.
Great neighborhood. I loved it. The location was fantastic. It checked all the boxes at the time, right? However, with that said, looking back on it, what an opportunity I missed out on by not purchasing that duplex or a triplex or even a four-unit building, right? Because if you don't need the space, right, and you can live in one of the units and collect rental income on the other three, well, now your mortgage is being paid for by the income from the other three units. You can live in there for as long as you can, right? And then when you need more space, you just simply depart, you know, that becomes a departure residence. You move out of the fourth unit. You now put a tenant in there. So now all four units are being rented, right? It's paying for itself, may even be generating a little bit of cash flow there as well. And then you purchase a condo, maybe you buy a townhome at that point. And then you do the same thing, right? You live in there as long as you can. Maybe at that point you run out of space. And at that point you buy a single family. Well, now you've got a four unit property where all four units are occupied and you're collecting rental income. And you've got either a condo or a townhome that you've now rented out and you're collecting rental income from that property, and now you're living in a single family home, but you now have four doors that you're collecting rental income on.
I am so passionate about this. Yeah,
absolutely.
And I am an example of it. I still live in the first duplex that I purchased.
Okay.
So I live on one side, I Airbnb the other side.
Okay.
It's amazing. It's, you know, quarter mile, half mile to the beach. It's a great
location.
By
the way, not to cut you off, I didn't even get into the Airbnb portion of it.
Sure.
I'm referring to just an annual rental, which of course with Airbnb, you can, there's a lot more income potential there,
totally.
Right? Even if you've got to factor in a property manager or an Airbnb host, whatever it may be, if you don't have the time to do it, there's still a lot of potential there.
Yep.
Why wouldn't someone do that? Right. I made the mistake because I didn't know any better, right? I wanted a condo, I wanted low maintenance, and I wanted to be east, right? So that's what I bought. I bought essentially a box, right?
I got lucky. I didn't really understand the consequences of either decision entirely. My whole thing was my sister and I lived together when we went to college, and we were renting a place together with some other roommates. And I was just like, and she had a whole bunch of dogs. And I was just like, oh man, I don't want to live with these dogs anymore. But how do I keep my sister close? And I'm like, oh, I'll buy a duplex. She can live on one side. I'll live on the other side. I don't have to live with these hairy, smelly dogs, right? So that's why I ended up in the duplex. And then she moved out over time, and then I leased it up, and I'm like, oh, this is really interesting. So that's how I ended up there. I only wish I had bought a four unit as an example. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's so much opportunity, and the biggest thing people have to keep in mind is they'll look at a property and say, well, I'm a first-time buyer. You know, maybe I'm doing pretty well, right? They'll look at it, and they'll say, I can't afford that, right? But they don't know what it really takes to buy that. Most people think there's this big misconception, or, you know, that you have to put 20 or 30% down to buy a four-unit property or a duplex. You don't. If you're buying a primary home, you can get in there with as little as 3.5% down if it's FHA. 3% conventional.
So right? You and I did one, I think this is the most recent one maybe that we did together, Lighthouse Point duplex, one on each side, so one bedroom, one bath, mm-hmm. on each side. The kid that we helped, great guy. He could probably afford, I think, like $450,000-$500,000 if it was a single family home, right? And he bought this duplex for almost $600,000, I think, if I remember. We're just using rough numbers, right? You and I did this together, and we've done this so many times that, and you probably don't even remember everybody that we've worked with that we've done this, but yeah. So
definitely not.
Yeah. So there's so many nuanced details when executing on this. Like, for example, vacant units, fully occupied units. What are you going to do if it's a primary? How do you get that one tenant out? How do we make that work for the loan? You know, all these little things. Or, hey, the rent is $1,000, but the market rent is $2,000. So you and I think, have become professionals at helping people house hack. He put 3.5% down, if I remember correctly. And he got a great rate at that time. It was awesome. And he's super happy with that. He Airbnbs the other side. I actually interviewed him on a podcast recently.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
okay,
to,
cool.
Just to talk about, he's about a year deep into it now. And he's just very happy with the execution that we were able to.
Yeah, I go back to it. The opportunity that people have that they don't realize, it, to me, it's incredible because they, I'll share a story with you. We had a buyer last week, and she says to me, I really like this one house. Can you run the numbers on it? I said, sure. She said, okay, they're asking $450,000, and, you know, I can only afford whatever the payment was, and it was like $2,400, $2,500. She was buying in Winter Haven. So we run the numbers. I send her a breakdown. She says, look, I can afford it, but I can only afford it at this number, and I don't think they're going to take that. And we're on a conference call. It was me and her agent. And I said to the both of them, why not just make the offer? What's the worst that can happen? What's the worst they can say? No?
Yeah.
You don't know them. You're not friends with them. You don't want to be friends with them. What's the difference? Just make the offer. She was like, you know what? You're right. We'll send it in. They offer $395,000. Property was on the market for $449,000. Comes back and says, if we go to $405,000, it's yours. So she sends me a text on Saturday. I wake up to it. She sent it late Friday night, and I woke up to it. Thank you so much. If it weren't for you, I would have never made this offer. I really appreciate your guidance through this. And what I'm getting at is this. You don't know what you don't know. So if you don't make an offer, it may be a lowball offer. They may say no. They may have to sell it. You look at a property, you may not be able to afford it, right? However, if you're getting rental income from the other three units, and they may already be leased out, right? So if the property's $700, $800, and you wanted to pay $450 or $5, well, if you're getting $1,200 from each unit, that's $3,600. If your payment's $6,000 a month, well, there you go. Your difference is $2,400. And now you just bought a property with four doors. Now, the reality is most people don't live in a four-unit property forever, right? So when that becomes your departure residence, you slide one more tenant in there, boom, you got four doors that are being occupied, and you're collecting rental income.